Hello everyone, this is Hardeep Rathod here from MedGenome. Good evening and a warm welcome to you to the online symposium on leukemias and minimal residual disease. We have three interesting sessions lined up for you, followed by an exciting panel discussion. At the outset, I would like to thank our speakers, Dr. Rahul Bhargava, Dr. Joseph John, and Dr. Arun Kumar for taking the time out from their busy schedule and enlightening us on this important topic. I would also like to thank our panelists, Dr. Nilesh Vasekar, Dr. Prathamesh Kulkarni, and Dr. Shruti P.S. for taking time out from their busy schedules to be a part of this panel and sharing their views on the important topic. Unfortunately, Dr. Swami Mahadev couldn't join us today in the panel discussion. Before I hand over to the speakers, I wanted to inform you that if you have any questions or comments, you can type them out in the Q&A window of the Zoom conferencing browser. We will also be sending across the recording of this symposium in case you miss out any points or would like to revisit some portions. Our first speaker for today is Dr. Rahul Bhargava. Dr. Rahul is Director and Head of Hematology, Hemato-Oncology and Stem Cell Transplant at Fortis Memorial Research Institute, Gurgaon. So without any further delay, I will now transfer the host to Dr. Rahul, who will take this symposium forward. Over to you, Dr. Rahul. You can start sharing your screen.
I would say thank you, MedGenome, for this opportunity, and thanks, Joseph. The idea for this 1 hour, as we know, there are just too many symposiums which are happening, and the take-home message has to be very, very key to the pack. And we need to understand what are we trying to understand and gain through these symposiums which we are doing. So the idea in today's thing is, how can we make our AMLs survive longer? And all that idea and the greed, I would put it as the greedy doctors, that every single patient who walks into their OPD should survive for next 20 years is what they want. And that is what tells Indian doctors mostly to see what they can do best for their patients, because we are generally put on a Twitter as low middle income group countries. But at the same time, the social problems which we face of not accepting the relapses is huge. So that's why we have the first chance as the best chance. And the data might be not on your side, or there will be a paucity of data, because the Americans will have the second chance and they can do multiple lines of therapies and show that overall survival is not different. But for us, that is not the question. So the thing is, why and what MRD is needed? What time point does it matter? Does it override the cytogenetics and molecular prognostication? Is it specific for certain mutations which you can move in, which are stable mutations, which you can utilize them as to monitor them? Does it lead to change in therapy? And which is the correct methodology, NGS flow or the PCRs? Next. To set the context, the idea was, next slide. The context was, that only 16.6% people of less than 60 years were alive at 10-year follow-up, people who didn't went for a transplant. And majority of people who were alive were from the group of AML and inversion 16. So it means if you don't do a transplant, it is dismal. Next. And the risk of relapse even after post-transplants continues to be there, but anywhere between 15 to 50% depending on the risk markers. Why I'm trying to tell you all this is, we need something more from the cytogenetics. Beyond cytogenetics, we want to understand how the cells, irrespective of the cytogenetics, have responded to the therapy which you have given. And majority of trials which they do from US are from cytarabine and idarubicin, while we do cytarabine plus donorubicin. Next. So MRD in AML prognosis, the curves you can already see. The blue curve is MRD negative at 1 and 2, which means after one cycle or two cycles. So again, the nomenclature in the West is slightly different. They tend to give two inductions followed by consolidation, while in India, at our center, we give one induction and followed by three consolidations. So these curves are way, way apart when we talk about the survival characteristics in MRD. So MRD is a cumulative sum of what we have done with the disease. Next. And similarly, for the bone marrow transplant, that before a transplant, if the MRD is positive, there are higher chances of relapses, where you can see the down curves with the dotted lines. You can yourself see the MRD positive has a deep impact on overall survival and the disease-free survival. Next. So pre-treatment characteristics are good. We have graduated over to doing the PCRs. We have graduated over to do NGS, because at our center, almost everybody gets an NGS done for an MDS and AML. But how does, you know, in vivo, the things are going to happen along with the chemotherapy? That is what the MRD is. So you need MRD because your survival is less if your MRD is positive. Next. And these are the good risk markers, which we all know. And there's a huge thing which has been happening on Twitter between MPN1 and FLT3 positive. What we need to do is all we know. So this is the risk stratification, but life has moved on beyond this. So there are certain people who will do well, even with the bad cytogenetic. And that's what we need to know. And that's what we need to understand with an MRD. Next. So how can we be better in 2020? Next. So rationale for MRD is already there. AML is a heterogeneous disorder. Vikram has already shown in many of the meetings the beautiful curve from our blood showing how many mutations can be at present in the AML setting. We are still fortunate that we don't have 10,000 mutations like a pancreatic cancer. We still have got in 200 genome-wide things. More than 1,000 genes were found to be mutated in at least one of the 200 cases analyzed. So this means there are many more genes which are mutated. And as you go on to the NGS, and as we will start doing the whole exon sequencing in the near future at the reasonable cost, you'll start finding more and more genetic variations. But which gene are going to be your target agent, which is stable, which tells you the MRD predictability that they are going to remain? And are they present in the blast compartment or a non-blast compartment is going to determine how you're going to interpret it. Because if you're even the MRD is positive, in 2020, we have reached this, we have confirmed it beyond doubt that MRD is required. But 2021 and 2022 might give us an answer what to do with those MRD being positive. And that's what we are going to show in the next couple of slides. Next. So MRD is basically has moved from a minimal residual disease, which gives you a satisfaction that only few left out cells are left and we will be able to kill it. But that's not the case. So that's why minimal residual disease has moved to measurable residual disease and has been defined as the persistence of leukemic cells after chemotherapy at numbers below the sensitivity detection level of routine morphology represent the sum of the effect of all relevant cellular resistance mechanisms, pharmacokinetic resistance, dosage and compliance, and other unknown factors affecting the effectiveness of a treatment. So you have established a bad marker, but you in a bad marker also you can have a negative MRD. So person who has got an MPN positive as well as FLT3 high FLT3 positive, if it is MRD negative, then many people in US will not take up for the transplant. Not like us where we NPM positive, FLT3 high positive, take the patient up for the transplant. And that's where the role of minimal residual disease might not be in the context setting of a randomized trial, but people do put their resistance because the data for MPN positive, FLT3 negative is still not there. Next. So methodologies are multicolor flow cytometry, which we use is 8-color flow, NGS and RT-PCRs. These are the three technological variants, and we'll just quickly discuss what each and everybody comes up with. Next. So these are the markers which can be used for a potential markers for flow cytometry. But look at this, when the right is NGS is NPN1, RUNX1, FLT3, IDH1 and IDH2. And the PCRs is CABP, FLT3, IDH1 and so on and so forth. But remember what happens to DNMT3, what happens to AXXL1, because those are the markers which are coming up for your NGS. Can that be utilized as a marker for MRD monitoring? We will soon come to know about it. But look at the markers which are like 4 or 5 in number, which are stable in nature, which are utilized as a markers for prognostication in the near future. And FLT3, we have been routinely monitoring and we have seen the subscripts rising onto the numbers. So the ratio number starts rising once you start doing it more and more transplants, because sorafenib is being utilized as 2 years maintenance for these patients. So FLT3 is a very, very stable marker, and we'll soon discuss about the NPM1 and RUNX1. Next. So flow cytometry, leukemic associated immunophenotype, and a different from normal pattern. So if you are rich like Tata Memorial, where you can have the taxpayer money and you can utilize 100 markers and find out a leukemic associated immunophenotype in everybody, which is different, which is stable, you can utilize it, or from a different from normal patterns. Because remember that the hematocons in these conditions are different from an ALL, where it can be utilized. But in AML, all looks normal. All the blasts looks normal. Even the regenerative blast looks normal. So what is happening is different from normal pattern. While ELN says LIP based different than normal approach. So combining both approaches required for monitoring MRD. Phenotypic changes and standardization is the most important thing. Phenotypic shift and a drift takes place during the chemotherapy sessions. Large antibody panels are required, and 1/3 of people with MRD negative will finally relapse. So this is what happens when a flow cytometric based methodology is utilized, but it's the most common thing and can be easily utilized. So it is on an 8-color flow. We don't have an 11-color flow at this present moment of time. Next. So real-time PCRs are being utilized for PML RAR alpha, which is not hidden from anybody. RUNX1, 821 can be very well be utilized in version 16, 6, 9, 11Q, 5, 11. If you have got these markers, these are real-time PCRs, can be very well utilized because these are very stable markers and the kinetics has also been defined. Like PML RAR alpha every 3 months for 2 years, which has been defined. Similarly, for 821 also it has been defined every 3 months for 2 years. While for inversion 16, it is 6 months for 2 years. While 6, 9, 11Q, they're all 3 months for every 2 years. Then it can be monitored because they are very, very stable. And if they are positive, they mean really positive. And when we talk about positivity, just not qualitative, but quantitative as well. Because the 3-log reduction has to be there to show that these people are going to do well. The kinetics of inversion 16 has been well charted out. It's a slow growing thing in comparison to 821. So what happens to 60% of our people? Our 821 data is 40% survival at 5 years. I would say not even 40, last we served was 38%. To be satisfied, we say 40%, but it was 38%. But what happens to 60% of our 821? Either they are CKD positive or they had a persistence of a transcripts leading to relapses. 60% of AML can be utilized for these real-time PCRs if you utilize them as a technology. Next. So PML RAR alpha, we all know bone marrow is the source for all of them. Next. So RUNX1 CBF detection in leukemias. This people have failed to achieve a 3-log reduction in RUNX1 transcript compared with the reference pre-treatment baseline by the end of the second month of consolidations are bad. These are the people who tends to do badly in these subsets of good risk marker. So even if you say, I don't want to utilize, people have got limited money. So let's say 30% people who are high risk, you're not going to utilize them. But what about the intermediate risk and the good risk people? Because if you do a transplant early on, the results are good, cost is less. But if you don't do a transplant and then they relapse, the cost becomes double. So what is more important is to identify these subsets of people who do not have a matching upfront, but their MRD monitoring can actually tell you how and when to do a transplant. So developed early molecular relapses could be improved by allogeneic transplant in first complete remission. And every 3 months, it has to be done for 24 months. So in your good risk markers, RUNX1 and CBF MYH11 detections, inversion 16 and 821, basically, you need to follow up this methodology of monitoring the patients. Next. NPM are found in approximately 1/3 of AML cases. NPM transcripts are typically highly expressed in diagnostic AML samples and can be utilized as a PCR for molecular subtypings of AML. And this is a robust marker. If it is still present in MRD, it portends a poor risk marker and a hallmark for disease relapse. Next. So best timing, when to do a time, that's a major important question, when to act upon. It is all after 2 cycles of chemotherapy and from the bone marrow. It is never from a peripheral blood, from the bone marrow after 2 cycles. 1 induction, 1 consolidation is what we need to see. But if you're really worried about, if you're after 2 cycles is positive, do you do a transplant? No. If after induction, after end of treatment, if it is positive, as you see, they have a negative connotation, prognostic value is negative, that they tend to relapse very early on. Next. So other mutated agents, mutated DNMT3A with up to 50% VF can persist in patients who have been in remission for several years. Another concern is that commonly mutated genes in AML such as TET2, DNMT3 and AXL1, which is called as DAT, can also be present in clonal hematopoiesis of undetermined significance. So it does not mean, so that's what I said, when you start doing NGS, you need to be very, very, very worried about what genes you are going to pick it up, and you have to choose them very carefully. So this data shows that while NPM1, RUNX1, Invasion 16 are a very stable marker for PCRs, but for rest of the markers, they can still be present in a healthy population as well. Next. So newer methodologies, next generation sequencing and digital PCRs are coming up, and people are trying on a FLT3 MPN based methodologies for next generation sequencing. Concordance of 71% was found in MRD by 28 panel on NGS and multicolor flow cytometry. So newer technologies are playing into the system, because the idea is how can we pick up 1 in 10,000 cells or 100,000 cells so that we can say these people are going to relapse. Next. Various ways we have already spoken about, then the applicability is flow cytometry is the commonest thing which is happening at this present moment of time. Next. So does it override cytogenetics and molecular prognostication? Answer to that is yes. Oh, it overrides, it becomes a MRD, it becomes an independent risk marker for early relapses. And these are the various papers which are have talked about. Next. Can MRD always predict relapses? MRD being negative and still relapses can occur. Yes. Re-emergence or evolution of the original dominant clone arise from minor subclones and developed as a secondary leukemia, or represent a completely separate therapy-related leukemias later down the line. So MRD is negative, still people can relapse. And that's why in the multiple trials, people have not been able to show intervention really makes a difference. And that's what we are going to see in 2022 and 2023. Next. So AML being a heterogeneous disorder, multiple genetic abnormality with complex interplay diagnosis as what leads to relapse. And this is what I've been talking about, which everybody shows in their presentations, how different clones tends to develop at a different time and can be the marker for disease. So you might be monitoring NPM, NPM, NPM1, but on a secondary, leukemias might occur from a non-NPM1 clone, which might lead to a relapse. So these are all hypotheses. So might not be 100% science, but yes, in certain patients, you can actually rule out. So in my understanding, if you have an NPM1 positive, which has got a positive predictive value of a relapse, but if it is negative, then the chances is that you might have a relapse from a different clone. That's what the data looks like at this present moment of time. Next. So MRD is still positive, MRD is positive, still relapses will not occur because confounded by persistence of genetic abnormalities, age-related clonal hematopoiesis, and this GTA, as we have spoken, can still be positive. So how you choose the marker is very, very important in MRD. Next. Eliminating minimal residual disease, can we do that? Last section is, can we do something? Now, we have spoken about MRD as an independent risk factor. It is an independent risk factor for beyond cytogenetics, how you have behaved during the chemotherapy, fine enough. But if you are MRD positive, after one cycle, two cycles, or enough treatment, can you do something? Like in ALL, where belinotumab is there, but can something be done for eliminating residual disease? The answer to that is probably coming up in the near future. And these are the molecules which can be utilized in the near future to eradicate MRD. And in post bone marrow transplant, we are utilizing azacitidine or midostaurin or sorafenib to eliminate the minimal residual disease at the end of treatment. Next. So risk-adaptive strategies would perform the risk-adapted non-randomized study in AML. Patients were assigned to allotransplant after second consolidation if the MRD was positive, but randomized studies are lacking. And there was some difference showing there was a superiority in a good risk marker, people who were positive. But these are one-off case reports and case series which has come up from China, but the randomized trials are still lacking. Next. Remission maintenance strategies are already there. There is a RELASAS trial which has spoken about azacitidine, just like ALL where you utilize dasatinib. Similarly, in AML or high-risk MDS, azacitidine has been utilized in these subsets to see how these people do post-transplants. So post-cycle and people in first study and second study both has shown some positive responses in people utilizing azacitidine post-MRD, post. Next. The aspect being investigated in UK National Cancer Research Institute, impact of MRD-directed therapy and outcome in health economics and quality of life through a monitor versus no monitor randomization. Next. So approach to MRD positive, should patient go directly to HCT or should further efforts be made to clear MRD before proceeding? Probably no randomized trial is there. If you can make the people easily negative, if you give too much chemotherapy after consolidation, you are tempted to give one more consolidation and that means additional cost, additional toxicity. Can you do that and does it going to help you out? The answer is still unknown. Is the source preferable to other? Yes, probably one donor than another. If there's no sibling transplant, then probably you can take up for the match unrelated or an haplotransplant. Does the presence of MRD affect the choice of preparatory regime? Probably in our setting, yes, we are going more towards myeloablative and adding omitting ATG to promote more of a graft versus leukemia effect. Do methods exist to prevent post-transplant relapses? The answer to that is yes. Azacitidine is being utilized either to enhance the graft versus leukemia effect as well as to keep the disease at the bay. But we are all trying to seek the answers for these questions. Next, last slide probably. So MRD conclusion, role is growing. Flu and PCR depending on type of mutation. Bone marrow is the source. Decision depends upon the type of mutation. Concerning transplant in first remission, determine whether the level of disease burden pre-transplant could be useful in tailoring the conditioning regime. Benefits to more widespread uptake of MRD surveillance post-transplant to identify residual disease at early stage to inform immunosuppression and direct have a donor lymphocyte infusion. Because we have done it at day 60, day 100. If the people are not developed any graft versus host disease or their MRD is still positive, just like ALL. ALL, the science is much more grown. In AML, it is growing. We have reached that we have proven beyond doubt that we require MRD. But how to utilize it for increasing the success rate post-transplant or after chemotherapy is needs to be seen. And that's where the discussion will come by. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rahul, for that insightful session. Our second speaker for today is Dr. Joseph John. Dr. Joseph is professor and head Department of Clinical Hematology, Hemato-Oncology and Bone Marrow Transplantation, Christian Medical College, CMC, Ludhiana. So I will hand over to Dr. Joseph. Dr. Joseph, if you can see, if you can share your screen and start presenting.
Can you see that now? Can everybody see the share screen now?
Yes.
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, good. Okay, so I see about 50 people who have joined and can they ask questions while the presentation is going on or all of them are muted?
They are muted, but they can ask it. I will read out the questions. They can type it in the Q&A.
My suggestion is let us have the discussion side by side and can you just tell me how much time we have for the talk and discussion?
You can take 20 minutes.
20 minutes. Okay. So at the outset, I must tell you a disclaimer that I am no expert in minimal residual disease or measurable residual disease. It has been an opportunity to learn and understand. So I would rather go by basics of it. Some of it is repetition from what Dr. Rahul has said. And I would share what I learned new in this and just to understand in the perspective of looking for these. Like Dr. Rahul said, all of us have one goal in any of the leukemia therapy is to prolong survival and improve the quality of life. And in that pursuit, we are majorly unsuccessful even after doing a transplant. And we are continuously looking at ways in predicting who is likely to relapse. Should we change the strategies upfront? At what point should we change the strategies, increase the treatment, reduce the complications of treatment? All of these questions are germane in our life on a daily basis. When we did not have access to lot of molecular, we just managed with blood counts. when we had little more understanding of things, we looked at bone marrow. As things improved, we looked at cytogenetics and then gave fish. We could count now 500 cells to 1,000 cells apart from this thing, and it could be more specific. After that, we said, okay, we should do flow cytometry where we can count another 1,000 or 10,000. Then came PCR. But in all of this, we need to understand the limitation and how we can further improvise upon our detection limits. And that is what we're looking at, measurable residual disease. And if we got much better than molecular PCR, at some point, we would call this something different because our the expertise keep increasing. When we look at MRD, we have two questions in mind. One, how do we detect this? How do we use that piece of information in treating a particular disease? And this presentation is mainly for ALL. Rahul elaborated on AML so far. For when I don't know anything, I start with 5W1H and so what. I keep telling this to my DM residents as well. We ask this 5W1H question. Rudyard Kipling asked this, and there's a poem around it. I don't want to get into that. But we would ask MRD in ALL from this format. What is MRD? Before I answer that question, we need to understand how many cells we have in our human body. Now, it is very astonishing to look at this PLOS paper. PLOS paper. And we understand that we have about 30 trillion cells, which is 10 to the power of 12 cells in our body. If we were to, share market floated, obviously bacteria would be taking the chairmanship among them, and staph epidermidis or probably E. coli would be the chairman of our human body because they outnumber us by 55% than any of the cells. Among these cells, which we have 30 trillion cells, red cells take the maximum share of 84%. Bone marrow is 2.5%. And that's what I want you to understand, the share market, share value of bone marrow cells in the whole body. So that's a distribution. So of course, the hematologists take the lion's share of 95% of the cells are looked after by the hematologists, and the rest are by the other specialties. So you can say that all the hematologists look after the cancer patients, or the other patients can proudly say that we look after 95% of the share market of the human body. Why did I say that? So approximately we have about 100 million cells, that is 10 to the power of 12 cells. And even if you look at 2.5% of that 30 trillion cells, this is the bone marrow cells, there are about still 10 to the power of 12 cells. That is about precisely 0.75 into 10 to the power of 12 cells. We know from basics that to have cancer, we have approximately 10 to the power of 12 cells. So, but then that is a fraction of this entire cells which we have. 1 kg is translating to approximately 10 to the power of 12 cells. That's the understanding we have. Nobody has sat and counted the number of cells. Now, when we talk about minimal or measurable residual disease, we are going to look at that one abnormal cell in the sea of 10 to the power of 12, that is trillion cells, 30 trillion, 2.5%, approximately 0.75 to 10 to the power of 12 cells. Now, if we were to find that one abnormal cells in a bone marrow, we were to count 100 cells or 500 cells, there should be at least 10 to the power of 10 abnormal cells in the body to find that one missing, one abnormal cell among the 10 to the power of 12 cells. So imagine the quantum of cells we need to have. 10,000 million cells should be there, abnormal cells should be there to pick up that one abnormal cell if you were to do the bone marrow. So that's the, that is a magnitude I want you to understand when we talk about minimal residual disease. As we impress upon and understand subsequently and make our tests more sensitive and specific. Now we believe that even if we have that one abnormal cell, we can get the relapse. And that's the concept of leukemic stem cell. And that's this picture which is talking about. This is our, at the time of diagnosis, you have the normal hematopoietic stem cell. You have the leukemic stem cell. You have the leukemic progenitor cells. And when we give chemotherapy, we are only knocking off the leukemic progenitor cells. And then there is left behind this, our healthy progenitor cells, which has the capability to form a relapse. So a patient with clinical remission can still harbor 10 to the power of 10 leukemic cells. PCR is able to pick up, say, 1 to 5 blasts per 1 lakh cells, which means to say that we should have at least 10 to the power of 6 cells, that is 1 million leukemic cells, to be there in the body. That's the contrast I want you to understand with this discussion. You need to have a million leukemic cells in your body for the PCR to pick up. When we talk about PCR, we epitomize PCR and say that PCR can pick up 10 to the power of minus 5 to minus 6, but put it the other way around. PCR can pick up only if we have 10 to the power of 6 leukemic cells, that is 1 million cells remaining. That's the contrast. This is a picture extrapolated from multiple myeloma, but however, the more the residual cells, the faster the dynamics of relapse, the lesser the leukemic cells, slower the dynamic of relapse, or the progression is not there. In a measurable residual disease, which we talk about, standard microscopy, you can say at least 5,000 in 1 lakh. But what about the rest of the 1 lakh? We cannot check that. A microscopy expert might say that, and the polymerase chain is 0.1 per 10 to the power of 5, that means 10 to the power of 6, 1 10 to the power of 6. Now the question is, why do we say that minimal residual disease or measurable residual disease is important? 1998 paper, they looked at the TCR or the T-cell receptor or immunoglobulin gene rearrangements, which is specific for a clonal marker of the leukemic cells. This was done by PCR, and they followed up these patients to 38 months and looked at whether they would relapse or not. Now, what is the mechanism? And this is where I think conceptually there could be a lot of confusion in many of the residents at least who have joined up this program. You have the TCR, you have the immunoglobulin rearrangement. TCR also has a similar VDJ rearrangement structure, which is there, which rearrangements and give the molecular signature for each of these persons. So at diagnosis, we need to take the blood cells, do this entire gene studies and find out what is the molecular signature of that individual, store it. And at the time post-induction, we need to take the cell and compare with this and say, is there a difference or is it the same or is it the same thing which is there? Imagine the amount of work which needs to be done. If you cannot find in TCR, you need to look that in the immunoglobulin heavy chain rearrangement. So two techniques: you concentrate, amplify the genes, and look at the TCR or immunoglobulin rearrangements. And they said that if the cells were 10 to the power of minus 2 or more, the relative risk is 16 times more riskier than the others. Or you can have, if it is after consolidation therapy, it is 15 times overall, to say that anything more than minus 10 to the power of minus 2 is bad. And that's the MRD and PFS which was there. If it was no residual disease, good. If there is residual disease, it is bad. Earlier, we looked at the microscope and said, you know, less than 5% blast or more than 5% blast. Now the question comes, less than 5% blast also can have non-blast looking abnormal cells in the marrow. So that's where we are catching. From 1998, we move on to 2017. Between that, a lot of cell studies came up with many, many aspects of looking at pediatric and adult. Instead of going to either each one of them, this is a good paper which was mentioned in the meta-analysis as a meta-analysis. So, highest form of evidence, need not look at anything else. This has proven undoubtedly that MRD is important. If MRD is positive, this is bad. If MRD is negative, this is good. This is in pediatrics, EFS and pediatric OS. Pretty interesting, a phenomenon of confidence interval. We all talk about confidence interval. Some of you interested, please look at that at Bayesian credibility interval. This is similar to confidence interval, but based on the post-test probability. Little different understanding to be done, but go look up the Bayesian credibility interval. Analogous to our confidence interval, because when we're looking at it, we are looking at the hazard ratio to say this is about 77% better than the no with MRD, and no MRD is 62%, 72% better with regarding to overall survival and otherwise. Okay, so same phenomenon has been proved in adults as well. So this is just to say that why MRD is important, and it is important in pediatrics and in adults. When they did as a prop, the forest plot on all these studies, MRD emerges as a clear winner with regard to EFS and OS. Now, like Dr. Rahul was saying, does it mean that this supersedes everything else? The answer is yes to some extent. But understand that this is something which you would get the answer after the initial therapy and not before that. So same thing in OS and EFS. Now comes the how answer. How is MRD detected? There are various ways. I've mentioned morphology when we didn't have anything else. When we had cytogenetics, we said cytogenetics is the most important thing. Then we said FISH, then we said multicolor flow cytometry, then there is then next generation flow cytometry, PCR, and now multiplex PCR and deep sequencing. Of course, the more technology we have and the investments we can make, we keep going up. And of course, this investigation should not be more expensive than the treatment at some point. That's the point where we have to reflect and say, patient is more important than the tests and the drugs which we give. Prerequisites for any of the PCR testing is specificity, sensitivity, reproducibility, and applicability. That is some three, four things we need to look at. Any tests when we are applying, what is the sensitivity? We talk about 10 to the power of 4, 5, 6. Specificity, ability to discriminate. Yes, we are looking at the TCR or immunoglobulin or the flow cytometric signature. And the most important thing, it should be reproducible and it should be applicable. Reproducible in various sectors, not only in major centers, but also to the masses. And it should be used as a therapy as well. When we look at the multicolor flow cytometry, there are various advantages and limitations. Like the previous talk, it was the immunophenotypic shift or drift which can happen. So the looks can change on the cells and we may not be able to find the correct answer when we do the flow cytometry. We can use the RQ-PCR by MRD. If it is a DNA, like if you are looking at the T-cell rearrangement or the immunoglobulin rearrangement, we look at the DNA. We can also look at RQ on the DNA. If it is a chromosomal rearrangement, fusion gene transcript, it can be detected by DNA, we go by DNA. If it cannot, we use RT-PCR as a DNA. So example is the BCR-ABL is RT-PCR, MLL-F4 is RT-PCR. If it can be, sorry, this should not have been here. This is an RT-PCR. Some of them is DNA-PCR, the other one is RT-PCR, reverse transcription. Now comes how do I choose between flow cytometry and PCR? Does it change with B cell and T cell, or should I use bone marrow and peripheral blood with regarding these are the questions which will emerge from this particular answer of how and what type of tests which we have. studies, then they looked at the studies on the concordance between flow cytometry and the PCR in the B and T cell. The answer is that the PCR and the flow cytometry could equally predict the marrow relapse in a B cell, which meant that both could be used as a tool to predict a marrow relapse. Whereas in T cell, PCR was superior to flow in predicting marrow relapse. It means to say that PCR has higher sensitivity than B cell. And even though B cell flow cytometry is fine, for a T cell, PCR is more important because you can have the marrow clear and flow cytometry coming negative for MRD, but PCR coming. So that is a distinction which we need to make. But unfortunately, across the country today, in ALL or in most centers, it is the flow cytometry based MRDs. So you have to apply your caution in using the MRD by flow cytometry when you are interpreting a T cell ALL. That's an important point to be taken home. None of this can predict an extramedullary relapse. So testicular relapse or a CNS relapse or any other extramedullary relapses cannot be predicted by this. So understand the limitation of using MRD. Don't be astonished to say that your MRD was negative and the patient had a testicular relapse. Next is, what is the best source? Should I send a peripheral blood? Should I send a bone marrow? In T cell, it was comparable whether you do a bone marrow or a blood. Whereas in B cell, marrow was more preferable. So B cell, marrow and flow. T cell, either bone marrow or flow, a bone marrow or peripheral blood, but PCR is preferable. That's the take-home point to me after this entire discussion. At the ground level, use the first draw sample. By and large, all of us are designed or trained to send the first draw for an aspirate for making a smear, but you have to readjust your thoughts and say, if it is post-induction marrow, remission status marrow, please send the MRD as the first sample. So that's something which you have to tell the residents and the technicians and the staff when you collect the marrow. There are multiplex PCR and deep sequencing which we can do, which I don't go into that. When do we say one is MRD positive or negative? Now that's another question. The MRD positive, when we say minimal residual disease positive, we are making it an exhaustive statement saying that even the minimum I have picked up and there is zero cells in the body. From the discussion I had in the beginning of the number of cells which could be still positive, in a negative MRD so-called, there could be still 10 to the power of 10 to 6 cells in the body and we can have a PCR negative. So those semantics, it is more modest to say that measurable residual disease, till such time we find a test which we can check the entire marrow, which is probably impossible because sampling techniques will not allow us to suck up all the marrow from the patient, check it and give it back. So you can call that MRD response, complete response, MRD persistent or MRD reappearance. MRD negative, as I said, is a misnomer there. We have all these survival functions and the predictions and the remission states. The cause of relapse can be multifactorial in all of this. Now, where do we apply the MRD interpretation? Now, either we can apply that post-induction and based on that, we can risk stratify. Everybody likes to risk stratify so that we can use the therapeutic interventions and give predictions. Now, I keep telling this. The palmist looked at the hand, the astrologers look at the stars and we look at the Kaplan-Meier. And now MRD to predict how many years one has to live by and what remedial measures we need to take in terms of intensifying therapy or doing a transplant. So there are various methods, but now the MRD is creeping into the risk stratification, which is good. At least we can define first. Once we define, we act upon it. But there are counterfactual and counterintuitive arguments on MRDs. Not all patients with MRD positivity will relapse clinically. Some patients will relapse despite negative MRD. So there are contradictory hypotheses we can generate here. What we identify initially may not be expressed in the leukemic clones. So there could be a shift and drift which will happen, and still we may go, red herrings may be there, and we may be going in one direction and we are misdirected from the beginning. There could be recurrent disease and occult malignant progenitor cells that lack the marker assayed and more populous progeny. So that's got the ability to progenerate much more, but it is not picked up. And it can persist and they can recapitulate the disease. Now the question is, who do we apply? It is very clear, children and adults, it is useful. Meta-analysis has proven that. And 70% of the children can have MRD detectable at the completion of induction therapy. So does that mean that at the end of induction, you have MRD positivity? Would you intensify? Should I wait for 6 more months and then do? These are questions which have not been answered in full. Please understand that phenomenon. So you have to be using your judgment whether you want to transplant a patient at the end of induction if they have, because in other words, we'll then end up offering 70% patients allotransplant. The PCR testing at different times, what methodology, cutoff values are still not very clear. But we know this magic of 0.01%, which means 0.001%, 1 in 1,000. If it is 1 in 1,000, please understand that that is 10,000, that means 4 zeros. If it is 4 zeros, the patient can potentially have 7 to 8 leukemic cells still in the body and not being picked up. Do we say that if you have 7 to 8 cells still in the body, they're unlikely to relapse? The answer is no. This, the probability of relapse may come down. That's all we can say. Right now, the magic is 0.01. After 10 years down the line, this may become 0.001 or 0.0001, depending upon what tests which we have easily available, applicable, and ubiquitously available. If it is PCR-based, you can risk stratify further. So MRD 0.01%, there is a probability of relapse. All of this will help us in discussing with the family and the patient on the probabilities and the strategies which we can take. There are various studies. I won't go into the details of each one of them. It is good to go through that. So what is the insights which we can get upon the MRDs? 1, escalation of therapy. 2, de-escalation of therapy as well. So if you have a higher sensitive test which has been negative, you can potentially de-escalate. But we have a higher specific test and that is potentially can predict a relapse, you escalate the therapy. So these are strategies which we look to minimize the therapy. Looking at some of the studies, we can do that, and I hope some meta-analysis will come up and we can go by that as the epitome of evidence there. As I said, not all MRD patients are destined to relapse, and that has been shown from many studies. Now, whether we will zoom into a particular fusion gene transcript is there, then the chances of relapse is less or more. We need to look into that as well. MRD in adults, we looked at it, 80% of the adults in ALL have MRD detected immediately following the induction as compared to 70% in children. But it is the post-induction, after a while, we need to look at it. The probes which we use, based on the probes, standardization can come in. Ultimately, if it is an intermediate or a high risk, we are anyway escalating the therapy there. So MRD will be most applicable in a standard risk ALL, where we want to sub-classify them into intermediate, high risk, and low risk among the standard risk. That is where probably MRD is going to play a major role, because we would have already intensified the intermediate risk and high risk based on our prior knowledge. Multi-parameter flow cytometry, and ultimately we ask the question, so what? Possible interpretation and intervention, prediction of relapse and long-term cure, whether we want to minimize or escalate. Decision needs to be transplant or no transplant, even in the absence of sibling or if you have a sibling. So that's the question which is unanswered. Whether to use sibling, haplo, or MUD in the absence of sibling, should we go ahead and do haplo in the first instance where the MRD is positive? Whether to use new monoclonal antibodies to reduce it? So there are variable understanding whether to timing the type of MRD. As we mentioned, for the B, it is better to do flow cytometry. and marrow. For a T, it is important to do PCR and PBS. Peripheral blood is okay to do. We need to use that for prognostication and improving the mortality morbidity. As I said, escalation or de-escalation, flow cytometry for escalation, PCR for de-escalation. It's based on the intent to which we need to intervene, we choose what test to be done. Of course, we know the potential interventions we have is the inotuzumab oseltamivir combination or blinatumomab to reduce the cells or even the CAR-T cells. Limitations we understand, lack of leukemic marker, non-standardized techniques, poorly defined cutoffs, and MRD target loss. Any unanswered question than the answers which we have. Likelihood of relapse to the MRD in phase one, how should we intensify, should we transplant or not, as I mentioned just now. What are the time points? We don't know. As of now, there is consensus on day 28 and correlating it with post-induction phase two, and then after phase two, only making a decision whether to intensify or not, not at the first instance of this thing. So we have a sense of disease going to come back. This is one review article, I mean, the How I Treat article, which came out in 2020, which was, I thought it was good to look at. They also talk about many aspects of MRD. Immune evasion post-BMT is leading to GBL effect is genomic loss, down-regulation of HLA genes, overexpression of the immune checkpoint ligands, and generation of an anti-inflammatory milieu. So all those are immune evasions, and how do we approach that? It's a good paper to look at. This is based on one person's, Dr. Alexandro from Greece, his approach there. More of an intuitive guidance based on extrapolating the a priori paper, it is needs to find more aspects to it. Rahul mentioned about considering FLT3 inhibitors, considering azacitidine, HMAs in these kind of settings. Those are reasonable strategies for AML. For an ALL, we know only about dasatinib, imatinib, TKIs. Whether to use inotuzumab post-transplant if there is MRD positive at a low dose. These are all discussions in the pipeline and sounds very effective and sounds logical. So that is where we are, and I would stop here and ask. I hope you understood what I understood from MRD. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Joseph, for this exciting session. I'm sure we all have quite a bit of clarity on the 5W1H and so what questions. So thank you for that. I now invite our third speaker, Dr. Arun Kumar. Dr. Arun is Scientific Affairs Manager at MedGenome Labs Limited. Dr. Arun, over to you.
A very good evening to the participants and the panelists. So today I will be talking on the strategies for molecular MRT estimation in leukemia. So here I will concentrate more on the molecular MRT, a good deal of which was covered by Dr. Bhargava. And I will try to also talk about certain recent advances in this arena, and we will take this further. So the agenda is that we look into the background, then some molecular markers that are used for MRD, PCR-based, and in detail about this immunoglobulin and T-cell receptor-based MRD detection by NGS, and finish it off with comparing various technologies. So the background is that, of course, we know the basic definition, well-covered MRD is the residual cancer cells that remain after a particular treatment, chemotherapy. And MRD detection obviously helps us to provide an objective methodology to establish deeper remission status and predict and get informed about the post-remission treatment and identify impending relapse and enable early intervention, and also allow us to identify more robust post-transplant surveillance. So the challenge in MRD is that the number of cells which are leukemic after a particular range of therapy is very less. And the number of the technology that we are going to adopt to identify that low number of cells is should be robust enough to identify the low number of cells. So MRD is commonly used in various leukemias, including ALL, AML, CLL, CML. CML is a famous BCR ABL that we use, and of course the multiple myeloma. So three major methods, multiparametric flow cytometry, polymerase chain reaction or PCR, and then we have the next generation sequencing. I'm not going to go into the details of the flow cytometry. It's well in vogue and there are better experts and people know about this in detail. So I'll just concentrate on this presentation on the PCR and the NGS. So the markers, molecular markers associated with various diseases or various leukemias that can be exploited to identify MRTR. Primarily, you can start with the immunoglobulin and the T cell receptor gene rearrangements, a very promising area of markers, which have been in vogue for a long, but the standardizations and approvals are coming up now. So the leukemia specific repertoire of the immunoglobulin or the T cell receptor genes can be used as a marker. And gene fusions or chromosomal translocations can be used as a marker for MRD. Examples, we know the BCR, ABL, PML, RARA, RUNX markers, etc. And you can also use certain markers which are mutated. For example, the mutated NPM1 or the gene expression of specific genes like that of WT1 can also be used as a MRD marker. And different diseases have different specific markers. For example, the ALL, we can use immunoglobulin or the T cell repertoire as a marker. ETV6, RUNX1 fusions or certain cryptic BCR ABL fusions that are found in ALL can be used as a marker. Likewise for AML, PML RARA, the RUNX1T1 fusions or mutated NPM1 can be used as a marker. Although you have, as Dr. Rahul Bhargava clearly said, AML is such a diverse disease with respect to the genetics, you do have other gene mutations such as the FLT3 ITD or the FLT3 TKD mutations, KRAS, ASXL1, IDH1, etc. But the recent guidelines of the ELN states that these markers, the FLT3 or the ASXL, IDH and all, should not be used as a single marker of MRD. For example, how we use BCR, ABL and CML, you cannot replicate the same for FLT3 or IDH1 because of certain biological nature of the gene. One reason which Dr. Rahul Bhargava was wondering was whether ASXL1 can become a MRD marker in the future. There is a good possibility, but the challenge is that many ASXL1 mutations are also, some are also germline in nature, which creates a challenge to be used as a MRD. So what the ELN says is that if at all any of these markers are mutated, don't use it in isolation. Take it along with any other marker of AML for MRD purposes. For multiple myeloma, immunoglobulin repertoire can be used. For CLL, immunoglobulin or the T and T cell repertoire can be used as a marker. So these are all molecular markers. So the PCR-based methods have been used for a while. We all know the polymerase chain reaction. It essentially helps us to identify specific gene aberrations or gene signatures, and also helps us to quantify that genetic aberration, which is a direct measurement of the minimal residual disease. So it can generally have a sensitivity of up to 10 to the power of minus 5. Certain modifications of PCR like that of droplet digital PCR can have a higher sensitivity of up to 10 to the power of minus 6. And the MRD requires at least 10 to the power of 6 cells obtained from the patient's bone marrow for doing a PCR experiment. Two common types of the flavors of real-time PCR that is commonly used to do the MRD are quantitative real-time PCR or the qPCR as we generally call. So it essentially estimates or quantifies the amount of gene or the mRNA transcript that is there in a particular sample. So it is a pretty sensitive method and it has been used very extensively in molecular MRD detection. So basically it uses a combination of primers and probes which are fluorescently labeled to identify the particular genetic mutation. The second one is the reverse transcriptase PCR, or sometimes called as RT-PCR, is essentially identifying the presence of gene transcript. So transcript is the mRNA which is expressed from the particular gene. So for example, PML RARA, we essentially look into the level of mRNA that is there in the sample rather than directly detecting the gene. So this is generally considered to be a better and more accurate method of identifying MRT. So reverse transcriptase is basically the enzyme that converts the mRNA to the DNA. In this case, it's called as a cDNA or the complementary DNA. And of course, the reverse transcriptase PCR can also be quantitative, or is all, in almost most cases of MRT is quantitative in nature, where you can identify the level of transcripts that are there. So the detection of genetic aberrations by real-time PCR involves the use of something called as an ASO or allele-specific oligonucleotide. Oligonucleotide are short stretches of nucleotides that are very specific to the allele or to the mutation we are going to detect. If it is a PML RARA, the prior probes are specific to the breakpoints of the PML and the RARA genes. Likewise, for BCR ABL, the probes are specific to the particular breakpoint of the gene. So what essentially we see in a real-time PCR, so this is the raw data that you generally see. On the x-axis, you have the cycles of the PCR. On the y-axis, you have the fluorescence intensity. And each line corresponds to the product being generated in every cycle of a particular sample. So this green line is what is called as a threshold, which is an empirical line where you can best differentiate various samples with respect to their fluorescence intensity. So for example, you cannot have a line here which is too low where you don't get good signals, or you can't have this line up here because the detection or the separation of the fluorescence is not very good here. So this line is called as a threshold line, and the cycle at which the particular sample crosses the threshold is called as a cycle threshold. So why I'm saying this is that smaller or lower is the cycle threshold, CT value, more concentrated is the particular gene or particular template. Whereas larger is a cycle threshold or a late amplification is seen, it means that the particular transcript is very low in its count in the particular sample. So we essentially run multiple copies of serial diluted templates to get a standard curve, following which we take the sample. Say, for example, this is the diagnostic sample of a PCR ABL, and this is a follow-up sample. You can see that the diagnostic sample has a cycle threshold of around 23, whereas the follow-up has somewhere around 27, meaning that the follow-up sample has a much lower concentration compared to the diagnostic sample. And always for a PCR reaction, especially when we are quantifying, for the sake of normalization, we always use a housekeeping gene. In most cases of these translocations, it is the ABL gene that we use. So you don't see that much of difference as you see with the translocation or the fusion genes in the housekeeping gene. So housekeeping genes, both pre and post, are almost coming together. And this is used for normalizing the curve. Right. So certain technical considerations for real-time PCR-based MRT are immunoglobulin or T-cell receptor-based MRT needs to be customized for every patient. The reason is that I will come to this particular aspect of immunoglobulin and T-cell receptor in the forthcoming slides, where you would have to design primers and probes specific for every patient. Whereas for common translocations for like BCR ABL or PML RARA, you of course have readily available primers and probes, and cDNA is to be used for all fusions and transcript measurements. And for new MRD marker, the expression level of the particular marker, be it a mutation or an expression or a fusion, needs to be established in the leukemic cells, and it needs to be carefully evaluated before that can be taken up as a marker. Appropriate housekeeping genes should be used for every assay for the purpose of normalization of the PCR reaction. Positive negative controls must be used with every reaction. And most importantly, if you are quantifying, you should use standards at various dilutions such that the entire range of CTs are covered or the cycle thresholds are covered. So these are certain technical considerations one need to consider for doing MRT by real-time PCR. So an example of BCR ABL MRT report is like this, where this is a very common one. You can see that you have the BCR ABL copy number and the ABL copy number. This is a very critical parameter that one needs to pay note into, because as an empirical value, the international recommendation is that you should have a minimum of 10,000 ABL copy numbers to be considered as a good successful reaction. So anything less than 10,000 could be possibly because of either drugs or hemolysis or any other condition, which might not be a good estimate of the ratio. And then for international scale of BCR-ABL testing, you have something called as a correction factor, which is essentially a factor which is estimated for every lot of the primers and probes that we use. So we estimate, we get the WHO recommended standards, and that standard is run with the specific set of primers and probes in every reaction. And that's after running the standard, we get a correction factor, which is normalized for the international scale estimation. So then you get the BCR-ABL in the percentage, and based on the type of therapy, you can look into the plot where initially you had around, this patient had 45% and it came down to close to 18% or so in a span of 6 months. And of course, this is again the way in which you have to interpret, and where you look into the percentage of BCR-ABL transcript, and you identify whether it is whether the patient has achieved a molecular response or not, and whether there is a 3-log reduction from the baseline or not, etc. All right. Next, I will move on to the next generation sequencing technology, where this is a very promising approach to identify MRD. So to briefly sum up what next generation sequencing is all about, you take a sample and you extract the DNA from the sample and you fragment it into pieces. So depending on the type of sequencers, you make the fragments. The length of the fragment depends on the model of the sequencer. So it ranges anywhere from 150 bases to 200, 250 bases, depending on the model of sequencer. Then you capture the specific genes using specific certain probes called RNA probes or BAIDs. Say, for example, I'm interested in sequencing the immunoglobulin variable gene alone, or I'm interested in sequencing JAK2 gene, for example, hypothetically. I have probes that are specific or complementary to the gene of interest, and they get hybridized to these fragments and they are pulled down. After pulling down the specific gene of interest, you ligate what is called as universal adapters on either side of the fragment, and that serves as a primer to do the sequencing reaction, and we get the raw data. So then comes the most challenging part of the next generation sequencing, which is the data analysis, where for every sample we generate gigabytes of data. So for an average 50 gene panel, for example, you will be getting close to 1 million reads, which are essentially 150 base pair fragments, which are there in 10 lakhs in count. And you essentially go, the next step is to map those reads to the reference genome. So you can see here, say, for example, this is a reference genome. Each one is a separate read. And you can see that this GG that is there in the reads is not there in the reference genome, means that this is an insertion in the particular read or in the particular cell. So the number of times each of the nucleotide in the reference genome is sequenced is called as the depth, read depth. So higher the read depth, more sensitive is the next generation sequencing. So essentially for a regular somatic mutation testing, we go for a read depth of around 250x and higher. So some considerations for MRD detection by NGS are that NGS can detect multiple gene variants in the same individual, which is a very good thing. And it can detect with a high specificity sensitivity of almost 10 to the power of -6. And many studies, few of which I'll be talking in the next few slides, have shown specific advantage of using NGS for MRD detection. But we should also understand certain limitations and challenges of every technology to better appreciate and understand the result. So PCR-based NGS experiments. So what I mean is, the previous slide I showed you capturing the gene using probes. But when there is a small one or two genes to be done, what we do is we amplify the gene and take the PCR product for NGS. So when such a strategy is used, many artifacts are introduced in the sequence during the PCR reactions. And now there are some very exciting algorithms, bioinformatic algorithms that can identify such artifacts and remove them. And there are also certain barcoding strategies that can identify that. Then you have the potential for detecting all somatic variants, but not all the somatic variants have a MRD value. And the limits of NGS detection needs to be carefully validated before using it as a MRD technique. And some variants may be related to the CHIP or the clonal hematopoiesis of intermediate potential. So The ASXL1, there are certain mutations in the FLT3 can also be chip related, which might not be an actual MRD in nature. So each gene or each marker needs to be understood before it, using it for a MRD. So we came across a case of NPM1 gene mutated for MRD, where it was a 37 years female diagnosed with AML. She was also FLT3 positive by fragment analysis, and the bone marrow aspirate was subjected to the comprehensive leukemia panel, where we identified three gene mutations, one in NPM1, the other is of course the FLT3 with the ITD, and there was also an IDH mutation. Now, you can see that the NPM1 was the mutation was seen at a mutant allele load of 34.8%. And the FLT3 was around 24.6, and IDH2 was 43.6%. And after 3 months of therapy, we did a fragment analysis for the NPM1 again, and we found that it was negative. So essentially, the detection of the NPM1 mutation was not done in that particular experiment, and further follow-up is underway. So we are expected to see how this patient turns out. Next, I will concentrate my talk on this exciting topic of immunoglobulin and the T-cell receptor repertoire diversity, which can be used as a MRD. So with a very brief background, we know the complexity of the immunoglobulin genes. It also holds good for the T-cell receptor gene, where you have hundreds of variable D and the J chain genes that are there for the light and the heavy chain. So C stands for the constant. So of these hundreds of genes, one variable gene, one D gene, and the one J gene joined together, where a recombination takes place in that particular B cell. And the, after this recombination takes place, somatic hypermutation takes place at specific junctional sites where it is given as a star. So there, somatic mutations where, you know, randomly certain nucleotides get added up in the recombined gene, which is the signature of that particular B cell or that particular T cell. So this is what is used as, this is what is exploited to identify MRD in leukemias. So essentially, say this is the variable gene, this is the D gene and the J gene which have recombined. And this where I have put as N is any nucleotide that has got inserted in this region, which is not there in our genome at all. So if we are able to identify this sequence here for that particular individual, that serves as a good marker for that particular clone of the B cell or the T cell. So in terms of complexity, this is how it is. In a normal individual, you have a polyclonal B cell or the T cells where each color represents one particular sequence of this VDJ. And that sequence is there only in that series of B cell or the T cell. In oligoclonal cells, where what happens is one or two cells or one or two clones tend to get amplified. And in a complete clonality, in a full-blown leukemic condition, this particular clone gets amplified, and majority of or almost most of the cells, leukemic, most of the WBCs end up having, lymphocytes end up having the same clone. So MRD detection needs to identify this single clone in an oligoclonal background. So the sensitivity of the technique must be so high. So typically what happens here is that the immunoglobulin heavy chain VDJ or the TJ, immunoglobulin kappa lambda receptor sequences are done, and certain fusions are also, IGH gene fusions are also taken up. And essentially you do the DNA extraction, then you do a multiplex amplifications of all these genes. And then you prepare the library, barcode it, and then you go take it for NGS. So here I just want to mention that this is an amplification-based sequencing and not a capture-based sequencing. Then you do the data analysis and get the clinical MRD report. Now, this data analysis logic is something I'll just touch upon in the next slide. So the repertoire of the sample is checked for, number one, dominant clones that are there in the particular sample. So out of the, if you can just refresh back the previous slide where multiple clones were there, relative frequency of the of every clone is checked, and to see which particular clone is overexpressed in that particular individual. Then these overexpressed dominant clones are checked against a database of B-cell repertoire to see whether they have been previously attributed to leukemias. And finally, these two are combined together and they are quantified and an MRD score is given. So I will show you a couple of studies where MRD by NGS has shown to be quite sensitive. So this is a case of multiple myeloma study where the IFM DFCI clinical trial was going on. From that, patients were selected and MRD was measured by flow cytometry and NGS for the immunoglobulin genes for at 2 points before and after maintenance therapy. So this is the plot at the MRD detected before the pre-maintenance therapy. So you can see that on the left side is the flow cytometry based estimate, on the right side is the NGS based estimate on the same set of samples. So totally 264 patients were done by NGS and 475 were done by assessed by flow cytometry. And this on the x-axis, you have the months since the MRD was measured. On the y-axis, you have the patients who did not progress. What is the percentage of patients who were not progressing? So this blue line are those who were MRD negative by flow cytometry. And you can see that almost 60% of them did not have progression, meaning the corollary is that 40% of those who were determined to be negative or MRD negative by flow cytometry turned out to be positive, turned out to have the disease. On the other hand, if you go for the NGS, because the detection limit is much higher, you can see that the MRD negative was given as 10 to the power of minus 6. And MRD positive was again given as more than 10 to the power of minus 4. Intermediate to that, you see a whole set which is between 10 to the power of 4 and 10 to the power of 5, which is completely missed by the flow cytometry. And they had an intermediate progression. Whereas 90%, 85 to 90% of those who were MRD negative by NGS had no progression. So meaning that 10 to 15% only had a progression. On the other hand, almost 100% of them who were MRD positive by NGS developed progression after 40 months. So the same was identified in the post-maintenance MRD estimate also, where you can see the classical difference place. Say here, the MRD negative, almost 60% of them were without progression, meaning 40% had progression later. And the similar estimates were also seen in the NGS. So point is, NGS-based immunoglobulin repertoire detection in multiple myeloma was a better methodology and more sensitive methodology to identify MRD in multiple myeloma patients than flow cytometry. Next one is the NGS-based MRD detection in ALL. So this was again a pretty interesting and seminal paper where 105 pediatric ALL patients were subjected to MRD measurement by flow, allele-specific oligonucleotide PCR, as well as the NGS. These were all DALL, so the immunoglobulin gene rearrangement were looked at. So on the left side, you have the flow cytometry MRD versus the sequencing MRD. And on this plot is the PCR-based MRD versus the sequencing MRD. And you can see that out of the 105 patients, almost 10 patients who were negative by flow cytometry still had MRD by NGS, detected by NGS. So almost 10% of these cases, 9 to 10% of these cases were missed by the flow cytometry. On the other hand, 3 patients who were negative by PCR showed up MRD by NGS, and 1 patient who was positive by PCR was negative by NGS. And upon follow-up, they found that this patient did not develop progression later, and it clearly shows that this could be a false positive by ASO PCR in this particular case. And MRD detection by NGS again in CLL, it was where 337 CLL patients as part of the CLL 14 study were subjected to MRD by NGS using both immunoglobulin and T cell receptor gene rearrangements after completion of the therapy. And the MRD threshold was set to 10 to the power of minus 5. And you can see here that on the y-axis is the days since MRD was measured. On the x-axis is the days, and the y-axis is the probability of progression-free survival. And this light blue line that you see here are MRD positive, And you see that the, by 1,200 days, the probability of progression-free survival reduces drastically. On the other hand, MRD positive by NGS, this N is equal to 17 and light gray color one that you see here, have a very high probability of being progression-free survival. So essentially the point I wanted to make here is that this immunoglobulin repertoire detection or the T cell receptor repertoire detection by NGS for these diseases is coming up, is showing very good promise because it's being very sensitive in nature. Very good established studies are there. And the point is this particular method has now recently been FDA approved. So just to give a quick comparison of the various molecular methods. So flow cytometry, real-time PCR for the translocation and allele-specific PCR for the immunoglobulin or the T cell receptor. Finally, the NGS. So the sensitivity is, the flow cytometry is sensitive up to 10 to the power of minus 4, whereas PCR can range for 10 to the power of minus 4 to 10 to the power of minus 5. And the NGS has a sensitivity of 10 to the power of minus 6. Detection method, almost fluorescent is the detection method for all, but of course in flow cytometry, it is antibodies tagged with fluorescent dyes, which is going to detect the cell surface markers. Whereas PCRs have primers or probes, depending on the type of PCR, which are tagged with the fluorescent molecule. And in NGS, every nucleotide is tagged with the fluorescent molecule, and that is a method of detection. The TAT is, of course, the least for flow cytometry. As soon as it gets to the lab, it's just 3 to 4 hours time that you get the flow cytometry report. Real-time PCR for translocations, it is around 4 to 6 days. And for the allele-specific, ASO PCR for immunoglobulin or the T cell receptor repertoire, it is around 4 weeks. That is purely because you have to identify the sequence by sequencing the immunoglobulin repertoire of the patient, then design primers for the specific allele that is there in the patient, and then you have to do the PCR, which takes anywhere from 3 to 4 weeks time. Finally, the NGS does not require patient-based customization, and the turnaround time is around 2 weeks. Standardization, flow cytometry is a well-established protocol, well-standardized by various consortia across the globe. And for real-time PCR also, for certain specific translocations, you have a well-standardized protocols like PCR, ABL, PML, RARA are quite well-standardized across the globe. For the ASO PCR for immunoglobulin and the T cell receptor repertoire, you have limited standardizations available, still a long way to go. Whereas for the NGS, particularly the FDA approval is specific for the immunoglobulin or the T cell receptor, which is detected by the NGS. Whereas the NGS method for other mutations still needs standardization. Patient-specific reagents is required only for the allele-specific PCR for immunoglobulin and the T cell receptors, whereas the others do not need patient-specific reagents. So these are some of the references, and I thank you for this wonderful opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Arun, for this talk. I think this perfectly sets the stage for the last part of this symposium, which is a panel discussion. This panel discussion will be moderated by Dr. Rahul Bhargava. I will quickly introduce the panel. We have Dr. Nilesh Vasekar here, who is MD DM Hematology, practicing at HCG Manavta Cancer Center, Nasik. We have Dr. Pratish Kulkarni, who is consultant hematologist and stem cell transplant physician at Nanavati Hospital. And we have Dr. Shruti, who is a hematopathologist at Medgenome Labs Limited. So Dr. Arun, I will project the presentation you had shared as case study, as a panel discussion.
Rahul has shared.
Hi. Okay, so thank you. Thanks, Nilesh. Thanks, Dr. Shruti. Hello.
Hello.
Are you there?
Hello.
Yes, sir,
we are there.
Oh, perfect. So good. Yeah. Good to have all of you. So the idea is just there are two cases to bring out your own practices, and in no particular order, you can actually speak about what to do in these such patients. Because the whole idea is how we are going to proceed in our clinical day-to-day practices, how we are going to change in a clinical practice is. That's what the whole thing is. Next slide. So the three people are there. So we need to see how, what, and what we are doing, because still in ALL it's a state of the art thing that MRD needs to be done, but has it arrived in our clinical practices? Because we know it takes long years to have a trickling effect on in India to adopt to technology as well as to interpret that. Because in majority of meeting, people will say, oh no, we don't do it because labs are not reliable. Should we do it? What if they're positive? We are spending money. But my friends, I will really, really be enthusiastic about the whole thing is health economic wise. If you do more tests, you have better idea of which to tell people which can go home or which needs an intensive chemotherapy. So upfront, if you have a TP53 mutation, through an NGS, you know that this guy has to collect 15-20 lakh rupees for a transplant. He is not going to become better. And that gives an opportunity to find him a place or an NGO where they can collect money. So I think the more we investigate, if we invest into investigation, that gives and reaps you a better dividend than only treating the patient. So this is a 28-year-old male, TLC of 12,821 translocation, underwent a chemotherapy with 7+3. Day 14 marrow, M1 marrow, day 28 marrow in morphological CR. So question is, do you do day 14 marrows routinely?
Yes, sir. We are doing it day 14 marrow.
Okay. I am not doing it, sir, routinely.
Okay. So the data is both the sides, that whether you do it or you don't do it. For me, day 14 marrow is why it is important, because if it shows blast, then within next 7 days, if the patient is afebrile, I can start with a chemotherapy, because that will end up saving him six days of extra hospitalization in the hospital. So every day we are counting then when we can shift the patient outside the hospital so as to save the cost. So should one do MRD in such cases? 821, 12,000 counts, no major complaints, day 28 marrow is morphological CR. So out of three panelists, should one do MRD in such cases? Will you do both? If you are doing, will you do a both the methodologies, the flow cytometry as well as the PCR?
So for this patient, sir, I would go for at the end of induction, MRD analysis with the help of PCR, as 821 is there. And if available, and if finances do permit, flow-based PCR also, I'll try to look at it.
So any difference, Dr. Shruti, Dr. Nilesh?
Same, sir.
Yeah,
same.
But the question is, now when we have a PCR-based methodology, why would you go for a flow-based one? Because 821 is pretty much a stable molecular marker where you can do it by PCR. And Dr. Shruti, is there any way that 821 translocation, which leads to a product of RUNX1, can you do it by NGS?
Yes, sir, we can do it by NGS, but still it is more expensive when compared to the PCR, RT-PCR. So I think it's better to go for the RT-PCR when compared to NGS. But I would like to say that we can go for both flow as well as PCR.
Because there will be the higher concordance. And yeah. Will you use a bone marrow as a source or a peripheral blood?
Yes, sir, bone marrow should be used for the flow cytometry based MRD. But we can use peripheral blood for the RT-PCR.
Peripheral blood for the RT-PCR?
Maybe once if you take the bone marrow, if you're sending it for flow cytometry, maybe the same sample can be used for both of them. Okay. For PCR based as well as for the flow cytometry based.
Perfect. Next slide.
Sir, I have a question over here.
Please.
Now you have done this day 14 marrow and day 28 marrow. So in day 14 marrow, is it only you see for the morphological remission status, or you do for the flow cytometry based MRD detection?
Okay, very nice question, Dr. Shruti. Any of the panelists would like to answer this, and then I can come back.
At our center, we are doing morpho-based, but whenever we are finding some abnormal cells on morpho, then only we are advising for flow-based analysis also.
Sir, what is this, day 14, how usually you expect, what will be the blast count or morphology-based blast percentage?
We expect less than 5%.
That is actually like what we say for the complete remission. But my question here is
if it is more than 5%, we are advising flow-based analysis to look at the population exactly, because we had similar, we are having similar cases where we do get a morphological remission on day 14, but on day 28, when marrow is repeated, we are getting more percentage of blast. So at day 14 also, if you have facility, you can go ahead with flow-based analysis. That's what I feel. Dr. Rahul?
Okay.
Yeah. So Dr. Shruti, your question is very straightforward and the answer is also what he has told is very right.
Yes.
So the thing is, day 14 marrow generally tends to come as diluted marrows and you do a biopsy along with that. The number of cells are so less that it is very, very, very difficult to do an MRD on top of it. So that is why what you do generally say is marrow blast percentage and then you do a CD34 on the bone marrow biopsy to see for the morphological whether it has been able to achieve an M1 marrow or not, which is less than 5%. Because there will be two scenarios which will occur. There are people who will be sitting at 80% blast. He has developed no fever. He saved through 7 plus 3, 7 days happy. The moment no fever, your heartbeat starts getting faster and faster. So sitting at 80% blast. Second scenario will be that he'll be sitting at 10% blast. Those are the late responders. Okay. So day 14 marrow, MRD has been standardized in a BFM protocol in ALL. But half of the world is still divided whether they do a day 14 marrow or not. So in our panelists, me and
Nilesh.
Me and Nilesh are doing bone marrows and other one is not doing. So that's why day 14 marrow is still not the holy grail for all of us.
Okay.
Does it answer?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, but coming back to the question, Dr. Shruti,
yes,
if the cost someday MedGenome brings it to 5,000 rupees for a single marker, A21 runs one mutation, NGS by technology would be far better than PCR, or PCR will still be superior than NGS for 821?
Sir, when we can detect in a cheaper way with the PCR, I think it's better to go for the PCR rather than going for NGS, because you can get the your report earlier, but in PCR. But in the NGS, it is like it takes at least 2 weeks. So you need not wait for you should not make a patient wait for 2 weeks to get his MRD report, I guess.
So that's a practical consideration. So
yeah, practically.
Ram has brought down the cost to 5,000 rupees for NGS for a one marker. Now the cost is same. Is there any superiority of the technology of PCR versus NGS in detecting MRD? Because you say morphology is 1 in 100 cells. Flow cytometry, 1 in 10,000 cells.
Yes.
PCR is almost similar or 1-0 extra. But can you say something like that for NGS also?
See, NGS is far better when compared to all these other three technologies. So if you can get a report earlier, so
perfect.
It's always better to go for NGS.
Perfect. So
can I just interject here? I'm Arun.
Rupees.
Can you hear me? Yeah, one small add-on to what Dr. Shruti said. Yes, NGS is, if at all, comparison by price is one aspect, but the cost to benefit ratio is something we need to see. And especially, many translocations which are novel might be missed by PCR, but still picked up by NGS. And sensitivity is at least 10 times more in NGS compared to the PCR.
So back to the panelists. Please.
Please go ahead.
Okay. So somebody, before we go ahead, to the panelists, there's a question from Dr. Shivaji. FLT3 ratio monitoring low or high? MRD is helpful.
Yes, sir.
So question is, FLT3 low or high, does MRD helpful?
No, if the FLT3 is high, definitely, I think that is what we consider as a high risk marker. There's a jury still out, I think, for the low FLT3. We do not know what implication, but there is a definitive evidence that with a high allelic ratio of FLT3, the risk is much, much higher. So I think if we can, on MRD, if we can document that, that would be very, very beneficial. But be it may, the ratio that we have, and if it has come down on MRD, whether it's low or high initially, it would definitely show us how the patient is progressing.
Perfect. So very nicely, aptly put. The question is, if it is low, will you be still happy to monitor MRD by FLT3? If it is high and now it has become low, will you change your management strategy to bone marrow transplant versus observation? Can you elaborate onto this, the panelists, please?
If it is high, definitely we will go ahead with transplant, sir, with available data and results of BMT and also, if possible, midostaurin along with it or sorafenib post transplant. But if it is low, to start with, definitely MRD will help. Both the MRD, like FLT3 based as well as flow cytometry based MRD, will definitely help in managing that patient in future.
Very nicely said. So the thing is, low or high post chemo and maintenance, if your FLT3 is high or FLT3 is present, that portends a poor marker. It does not mean that if it is negative, you will not relapse. The chances, if you have a positivity, there's 100% that you're going to relapse. If it is negative, there's a data that 30-40% people, irrespective of FLT3 being negative post transplant, post chemo, on maintenance, still tends to relapse. So that's why the proponents who are against MRD, they say, even if you have a negative MRD, still 30-40 substantial percent people tends to relapse. But our question is not that. Our Indian problem is that out of a subset where people are positive, can we subject them for a CR1 transplant is what we are looking at. So out of 100 people, if we transplant a CR1, so that we are coming from where the CR1 transplant is easier, much more manageable than CR2. If my CR1 transplant costs 12 lakh rupees, CR2 transplant will cost me 18 lakh rupees, which is higher. That is why we are trying to find out the subsets where we can do a CR1 and not allowing them to go for a relapses. In America, people with novel agents or with fancy things, they can afford to reach to a CR2. In India, there is nothing called a CR2. That is why we are discussing and thrashing out this data from this. Next slide. MRD was positive, but there was no change of treatment, 3 consolidation given. Still MRD was positive at the end of therapy. Will you do an allogenic transplant?
I would not, sir. I would still wait. Just the previous line you said is, people who have MRD negative can relapse, and people who are MRD positive can stay in remission for a long time. So the data is still not there. I would still wait in this case. If there's a morphological remission, patient is doing well, I would still wait.
Perfect. And other panelists?
I'll also, as Prathamesh said, because this RUNX1, RUNX-T1, you can get the MRD positivity for a long time. So I think if there is no there's no morphological presence of disease or flow cytometry based presence of the disease here, and if patient is doing well, we can wait.
Perfect. So the thing is, yes. So there's a data and a trial which is going along for doing allogenic transplant in these subset of patients who are positive at the end of consolidation. Next slide, please. I'll just show you some data. So a 3-log reduction in bone marrow between diagnosis at the end of induction or consolidation was associated with significantly different relapse rates and a trend for a longer OS in a multivariate analysis. patients who do not achieve a 3-log reduction in transcripts have poor outcomes, but it is still unclear whether these can be improved with allogeneic stem cell transplant or not. So prospectively, we are collecting a data on 821. We have got 4 patients. Out of that, 2 people have relapsed when they were 821 positive at the end of consolidation. The follow-up is only for 1 year right now, but 2 are continuing and have a persistence of a low 821 transcript still at 1 year. So friends, it is difficult to say who's going to relapse, but yes, if the numbers are high, if there's a qualitative PCR which is high for 821, they tend to relapse very often. And that's where I'm coming in a good risk, because both the cases are good risk. The simple reason for good risk is, the simple fact is because these good risk are not so good risk in Indian setting. Yeah. These people still tend to keep on relapsing. Your thought process, Dr. Shruti, and to the panelists.
No, I think my professor used to say that there is no such thing as a good risk AML. So there is no such thing. We have seen, I think about 50% is what I'll agree with you that when the good risk AMLs, about 50% of them do eventually relapse. I had a clinical question for you, Dr. Rahul. What is your schedule for marrows? Do you do marrows after every induction? The reason I'm asking is because in your slides, you showed that the American schedule that they have done is they have done MRD at the end of second chemo cycle. So do we stick to our current practice of doing at the end of induction, that is only one induction, or we do it at the end of consolidation one?
Very nice question. So if the MRD is negative after the induction, we don't do the next one after consolidation.
Okay.
If the MRD is positive, we tend to do at consolidation at the end of the at the end of the treatment also. So 3 bone marrows.
Okay.
And now we are also for 821 and inversion 16. We are following them up for every 3 months with an aspirate, seeing the bone marrow for the MRD.
Right.
And from the bone marrow MRD itself, from the bone marrow itself, the PCR as well as the flow goes.
Okay, sir.
Perfect. Next slide. Another. So 821 is 821 tends to relapse faster than inversion 16.
Yes.
If you see, the kinetics of inversion 16 transcripts are slower. That's where they say you can monitor every 6 months. But for 821, it is 3 months because they tend to relapse. Friends, please keep on monitoring and keep on keeping your data. Within a year, we'll have a 50 patient data to see how our 821s are doing. Because those are the patients where we need to do early transplant to save them. So next, 45-year female, NPM positive AML, induction 7+3, MRD is positive. It is just not this. The data has to be so much robust that not only allogeneic transplant, when we say allogeneic transplant in one breath, it gives me a shiver. Why? Because sibling transplant versus mud and haplo are two entirely different things. If you have an 821 where there's a sibling transplant, you will straight away go ahead and do a transplant. But what if 821 is, you don't have a sibling transplant and you see the transcripts are rising? Will you subject them for an haplo with a 30% mortality? I will agree. I will confess that 45% is the survival rate for a haplo in the country. You can't see a Western data and collaborate and say haplo and sibling transplants are same. Your thought process, panelists.
Definitely, sir. I think MSD ek taraf or haplo and are totally different. I would not subject at least a good risk AML to unmatched donor or a non-matched sibling donor.
Exactly. Until unless this is the world is doomed and he's going to relapse for sure.
Yes.
Till that time, no. Perfect. So 45-year-old NPM positive, 7+3, MRD is still positive at the end of consolidation. This time MRD was positive induction, after induction as well as consolidation. So what next? BMT or chemo?
Chemo, sir.
Chemo? Anybody for BMT?
BMT, sir. BMT.
BMT.
Yeah,
because NPM1 positive is a good risk marker.
Right.
But so chemo was continued. MRD post 3 cycle is still positive. It is a hardy one, which is not NPM1 is not going anywhere. Next slide. Panelist, what is your next thought process?
Taking for BMT, sir.
Taking for BMT, perfect. So MPM1 MRD remains negative in PB, peripheral blood, but positive in bone marrow. After the end of treatment, transcript should be closely monitored in both blood and a bone marrow every 4 weeks for at least 3 months. If an upward trajectory of MRD as defined as long increase in either bone marrow or peripheral blood is detected, consideration should be given to salvage treatment. If arising MRD titer is not confirmed or MRD becomes undetectable, then retesting may be performed at 3 months interval for at least first 2 years after the end of treatment. So Dr. Shruti,
yes,
how will you say which patient the peripheral blood or the bone marrow should be utilized? Because in America, they have the luxury of doing both from the peripheral blood and the bone marrow. Can we do that in India? And if not, if one sample has to be taken, which one will be your choice?
Bone marrow.
Bone marrow.
Yes,
any other panelist differs with that?
Bone because marrow. Your first line itself says it's negative in the PB and positive in the bone marrow. So it's always better to go for the bone marrow.
Yes.
Yeah.
So bone marrow is the preferred source. And preferred. NPM is not like 821 or inversion 16 where it can just persist. If the NPM1 is positive, the patient tend to relapse. And that's what where the maintenance starts. Maintenance roles will start coming in or doing early bone marrow transplant. The panelists, one very peculiar thing is, in these subsets of people, how many bone marrows will you do? Are you willing to subject your AML patients every 3 months for 2 years, just like APML? Because European groups and American groups are saying, and a blood article also talking about every 3 months bone marrows for first 2 years for 821, inversion 16 and NPM1 positive AMLs. What is your thought process?
Sir, I think that is better than subjecting the patient for allotransplant.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Another option for that? So now thing is, do we feel that now in India that we need to be doing more marrows than the previous era?
Yes, yes, sir. We should.
Yes, sir.
He is very right that allo comes with its own morbidities, and if you have a very close data that the transcripts are rising, but at the same time, how many labs are willing to give a quantitative PCR values of 821, inversion 16, PML, RR, alpha, JAK2? So that's what also we need to see, that is, Dr. Shruti, is Medgenome giving a PCR qualitative or quantitative?
Sir, we are giving qualitative for PML, RARA.
And how much does it technology and the cost goes up if you have to get for a quantitative values for these transcripts? Dr. Shruti?
Hello, yes, sir.
Yeah, what is the technological challenges and the cost which goes up if you are asking for a quantitative checkup? Quantitative values for PCR, for PML, RAR, alpha, RUNX1 and other.
I think Dr. Arun will be able to answer this question. Dr. Arun,
sure,
are you there?
Sure, yeah, I'm there. Sure, Dr. Rahul. Yes, the cost is going to increase primarily, you know, for every sample. Even if it is a singular sample, we would have to run 3 to 4 standards along with positive and negative controls. So I see an increase of at least 20 to 30% more. I mean, it's a very rough estimate, I'm saying.
Okay, so 20 to 30%.
Yes, and abiding by the international guidelines, getting the standards and running with every reaction is a bit expensive.
Perfect. So any other questions panelists like to ask or final comments? Because it's already 5:56.
Sir, I have a question.
Please.
So this is actually not related to these two cases, but it is actually related to Dr. Joseph's presentation. Sir had told that in case of T-cell MRD, T-cell ALL MRD, he said rather than flow cytometry, PCR based method is the better one compared to flow. Right, sir?
Yeah, better sensitivity.
Right. But now I have a question here, is that like if it is a PCR based, then what marker are we going to use in case of T-cell ALL?
Well, I think my...
what is it?
So that question can be answered by my lab colleagues. I might not be the specialist into that actually.
Okay. Because like in case of B-cell ALL, like if we can have a BCR ABL minor positive where we, it's like pH positive. So we go for PCR based technology and for the MRD as well. So, but when it comes to T-cell ALL, like what is that marker which is helpful for us for MRD detection in case of PCR? Because we, I usually see clinicians sending us for the flow cytometry based MRD for T-cell ALL, but I had not seen this PCR based. So I just wanted to have some information.
I'll tell you from my experience for a few of the patients we have managed with Singapore. There in Singapore, they do it IgG mutation studies rather than the flow-based PCRs.
Okay.
So they have all gone, and iCycle also, which is going on as an Indian collaborative ALL group with Bhaskar Saha, they're all doing a somatic mutations as a PCR-based technology rather than just flow.
Okay.
So B cell, I can tell you, but I'm not sure
about B cell. T-cell, yeah. I had a doubt with T-cell itself. Yeah. Okay, sir. Bye.
So with this, we come to an end, and I hand over to the organizers for giving us an opportunity. But the whole learning point is that AML MRD is ripe, and we need to start doing it, start collecting our own data to answer our own questions, because believe me, life does not give us a second chance. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Rahul, and the panelists for this insightful panel discussion. So that's about it for this symposium. I'd like to thank our speakers and panelists again for talking to us about this important topic. If you have any more questions or comments, please don't hesitate to get in touch with us at diagnostics@medgenome.com. So thank you again for attending this webinar, and hope it was beneficial. Until next time, goodbye.
Thank you, all the faculty.
Thank you.
Bye.